Evening, guys. It's Craig Renwick here. Well, we're in the bit amidst a pandemic just now. Everybody's stuck in the house. We're all in the same boat, pardon the pun. I know everybody must be desperate to get out fishing. I know I am. But there's more to life than fishing. I think it's important that everybody stays in the house just now. Everybody looks after their loved ones. And I'm sure the Pike will still be there once all this is over and done with. To beat the boredom, Foxes came up with the idea of doing a Q&A competition. The winner receiving 3 Fox replicant lures. We've had a great response to this. We've had lots of good entries. Unfortunately, I've had to whittle them down a bit. So I've picked 15 of the ones that I think are the best. I'm going to try and answer them as best I can. And at the end, I'll pick a winner. So, good luck. Well, first off, we've got Paul Garrigan. He asks, do you think there's any truth in certain waters being more receptive to certain methods? Yes, I do. Certain waters can be great lure waters. Other waters can be great deadbait waters and so forth. I think the most important thing that you can do is get out there and just try it, to be honest. Cast lures if you're catching fish on lures, stick with lures. If you're catching fish on deads, stick with deads. It's one of the things that you need to be. You need to be a good lure angler. You need to be a good deadbait angler. And to be honest, the harder waters and the harder that they are, they make you a better angler. Because you're sort of honing your skills. If you're catching fish on lures and you're not catching fish on deadbaits, for example, it's making you a better lure angler because you're constantly having to change things up a bit to continually catching fish. I do this quite regularly on the waters that I fish. For example, at the start of the year, the waters can be quite clear. So most of the time I'm out fishing lures on them. And then come December, we start getting some heavy rain, some snow. The waters go cold. They're not as easy to catch on lures. That's when I start deadbaiting. And that's when I start catching them. Days if I was to lure fish straight through, I wouldn't catch them. Whereas knowing when to change, that's the key. Give them what they want, when they want. Cheers. Next up, we've got Dave Preston. He asks, what tips would you give me to try and catch my first pike off the surface? Ooh, great fun. Surface lure fishing. Number one tip, go early in the morning or late at night. Low light levels, that's the key to catching pike off the top. Lure-wise, if you can fish floating jerkbaits like the slider, sweeper, and like sort of things like bobbers, like the Salmo Fury. It's a small 7 centimetre. It only weighs about 10 grams, a floating lure. Fish those sort of lures early in the morning or late at night. Anything that creates a sort of wake to get the pike's attention. If you can fish in shallow water as well, it's a big advantage, obviously. The pike always look up, being binocular vision or whatever they've got, they sort of look up. Shallow water will certainly increase your odds of catching fish on top waters. Obviously, a pike's not going to come up 20 foot off the bottom to hit a top water. I know what happened, but your chances are quite rare. Try and fish around structure. Sort of, if you're fishing a gravel pit, for example, fish under trees, things like that, weed beds, things like that. Anywhere, basically, a pike are going to be holding up. And that's it, pretty much. Just give it a go and getting about it. Next question is from Andy Cheatham. I hope I've said that right. He says, what trebles do you use on rocky, snaggy waters when you're fishing the replicants? Well, on the realistic, the old style replicants, when they first came out, and even on the new style realistic replicants, they first were introduced using the extra strong power point trebles, which is a heavy gauge wire hook These, well, although they were great hooks, they wouldn't really open up when you needed them to. Thankfully, Fox has now changed them to the tremolos that I'm using just now. I'm going to show you them in a minute. But that's the problem. If you're using, if you're fishing rocky swims, you need a treble that's going to open up. The trebles that are now on the replicants are these ones. Don't know if you can see, but they're still calling them extra strong trebles. They are still strong enough. They're never going to open up my pike anyway. But they will bend when you need them to, which is the most important thing when you're fishing rocky areas. But they won't open up if you get snagged on, say, rope or bark. Whereas when that happens, you need to go down on your split rings. I use 30, 40 pound breaking strain split rings. So they'll open up, providing that you're using heavy enough braid. You can pull for a break. You're not going to pull for a break, sorry. You're going to, when you pull hard enough, the split ring will open up. Last thing you want to do is be losing expensive lures. Fox isn't here to try and scam you out of selling you lots of lures that you're going to lose. Do you know what I mean? We want to try and get the best out of the lures as you can. So that's basically it. Use a fine wire or go lighter on your split rings. Simple as that. Good luck. Next question's from Matt Wooldridge. He asks, when would you make the decision to stop fishing certain waters, and is there any waters that you keep going back to because of their potential? That's a good question. That's something that I think about all the time as well. I class myself as a big pike angler. I want to try and catch as many big pike as I can. And to do so, I need to be fishing the right waters. I fish lots of waters. One thing that they've all got in common is they've all got big pike in them. I'm fishing for 30s most of the time. I catch a lot of 20s, but to be honest, that's not the 20s I want to catch. I want to be catching the 30s, the big 30s. So when I make the decision to stop fishing waters, is mostly down to pressure. The type of waters that I fish, not a lot of people fish, if not just myself and my friends. So that's the kind of waters I like, that's the kind of waters I want to be on. Once angle pressure comes into it, I lose interest, because basically I don't like competition. I know it sounds a bit of a conundrum basically, but I want all the odds stacked in my favour. I want to be the one to catch the fish. If there's other people fishing it, you know what happens. There's trebles and fish, and people might not handle them as best as you do or other anglers do. So fish die. That's the most important thing. Pike thrive on neglect. So basically that's it. And any waters that I keep going back to because of their potential, I've got a few waters that I fish just on my own. That's waters that I'll always go back, because I know there's big fish in them. I know that I'm looking after them. I know that I'll always catch them. I'm doing my best to just catch as big fish as I can. But waters such as the likes of Loch Lomond, for example. Loch Lomond's half an hour drive from me. It's a great pike water. It's probably the easiest water if you want to catch a wild 20 pound pike. Go to Loch Lomond. That's a water that I keep going back to, not just for nostalgia, but it's just a great water. There's a lot of people fish it, but it's always going to throw up big pike. So that's it. Thanks. Next question is from Robert Q. He says, you're retrieving a lure back to the boat. You notice a massive shape behind the lure. What's your instant reaction? Speed up or pause? It's always one of them things. You either speed up and the fish loses interest, or you pause and the fish loses interest. I think it's all down to what happens on the day. Whatever you choose and whatever works. Do you know what I mean? It's one of them things. Mostly I try and pause it. Well, it depends how far back you can see the pike following. If it's a good distance back, then I'll throw in a couple of pauses, and that's usually when the pike will engulf it. If no, you can try speeding it up slightly. I'll just do a couple of quick turns of the handle of the reel, and then a big pause. That's usually when the pike will just, the momentum will carry it forward, then I'll just take it. If you're reeling in and the pike follows you all the way to the side of the boat, just turns and goes away, well, you know that there's a pike in the area that's interested. What it can do is put, for example, if you're fishing a replicant, you got to follow, stick on a jerkbait or something like that, something that would be a bit more aggressive action, something that's going to catch its eye and make look an easier meal for the pike. Something like that works wonders time and time again. Another thing is just keep casting. You know it's there. You know it's interested. If the fish keeps following you, and you know, sometimes they just do that. They just follow out of just pure interest, no intention eating. Could be that they've got other things in their mind, like spawning, or they've got a belly full of fish that they're not really eating, or maybe they're just territorial fish. They're trying to push the fish. The lure out of the way, I don't know. It happens. Sometimes they're just easy to catch and sometimes they're not. Next question is from Robert Laurie. He asks, what does a replicant offer that a well-placed live bait can't? Good question. Probably a live bait's the most effective way of catching a pike. It sends out vibrations, It does basically everything. It's a natural food source for a pike. But there's more to life than just throwing out a live bait and catching a pike. Probably the easiest way to catch one, to be honest, but there's more enjoyment than fishing for pike. Lure fishing is brilliant, I love it. The thing that I like more about lure fishing than say live baiting or dead baiting is you can cover so much water quicker with a lure than you can with baits. It's just simple as that. If there's any feeding fish that are going to take an interest in your lure, you'll catch them fairly quickly. And nothing else matches the hit that you get off a big pike on a lure smashing into it. So that's my answer. Next up, Richie Miller asks, should there be a closed season in Scotland for pike? Definitely. Especially this time of year. Well, with what's going on just now, it's great for the pike. Everybody's off, everybody's sitting in the house. The pike are getting a break when they need it most, to be honest. If I was going to put in a closed season for pike, I would do it March, April... March to the end of April. May usually they're all done. They're all back on the feed. They're all well mended and they're all fighting fit again. So definitely we need it. There's a lot more pike anglers these days. A lot fewer pike to be caught. But something like that I would definitely encourage. Next up, Paul Armit says, how would you describe the adrenaline rush you get when you see a float slide away or a big pike follow your lure right in? Well, out the two, seeing a big pike follow my lure, there's nothing done better than that. Last year I was fishing a water down in Wales and I seen a 30 pounder, the water's gin clear, I seen a 30 pound pike come out from under a tree and follow my lure 30 yards back to the boat. No matter what I'd done, this fish wouldn't take. It's just one of the ones where they're either feeding or they're not, but seeing a big fish like that follow your lure in gin clear water, there's nothing better. How would I describe the rush I get when I see the float sliding away? To be honest, I'm used to it now, but a lot of the fishing that I do, especially dead baits, with dead baits, it's sort of from December onwards. The water's a lot colder. The pike aren't as easy to catch on lures. So that's the time of year that I fish deadbaits from the boat using floats. So when I'm fishing, a lot, there's nothing better than seeing the float slide away. It's cracking. Yeah, I get an adrenaline rush from seeing the float slide away. Nah, it happens that regularly that you get used to it. I've caught so many pike that I'm waiting for it to slide away. It's almost like I can set my watch at certain points and when I know I'm going to get a run. But there's nothing better than striking the float going away, reeling into it, striking, and you just boof, 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 the big first initial head shakes. That's what I love. That's when the heart starts going. Nothing beats it. Next question is from Michael Stoker. He says, what's your best lure setup for my 11-year-old daughter and what lures would you recommend? Well, if it's for your daughter, I would recommend something around 10 to 50 grams, sort of 7.5 foot long. This rod that I'm using is the Big Bait Spin, which is 710, 40 to 160 grams. It's not really going to be ideal for your daughter because it's quite a stiff rod. It's quite an expensive rod as well. That's with a 4000 prism reel. That's the rod that I would use from the bank. I know that you're asking for a rod for the bank as well, so that's what I use, but I wouldn't recommend it for an 11-year-old girl, to be honest. The last thing you want to do is for her to break a good rod, especially if she's new into lure fishing. She probably will. It's no disrespect to your daughter, but it happens. I was the same when I was young. For that, I would recommend the Prism X Lure and Shad, which is 10 to 50 grams. It's 7.5 foot long. It's a perfect lure rod for your daughter. Couple that with a Prism 4000 sized reel, sort of lures she's going to be using, 5-inch replicants, shallow replicants, they work perfect from the bank, floating sliders, sort of that sort of size, perfect. They're going to catch loads of fish. What other sort of lures? Other salmos, salmo sweepers, things like that. Easy to work, catch loads of fish. Go for it. Next up is a question from Kirk Wright. He says, do you think certain waters respond better to certain lures? Definitely. Wild waters, especially pike, waters where the pike are hungry, at times they can basically take anything that you throw at them. As long as you work it right, pike will have them. So things like jet baits, stuff like that. Pike go daft for them. Swim baits, replicants, things like that. You can't go wrong. Cast them out, twitch them back, reel them in, straightforward. Easy peasy. Other waters, such like trout waters, the pike are well fed, they're hard to catch. You need sort of something that mimics their diet that they're eating regularly. Trout waters are notorious waters for being hard waters to catch on lures, simply because they're well fed. They're big lazy buggers, to be honest. You have to sort of entice them into feeding sometimes. Lures like replicants, brilliant. Cast in, let it sink down, and reel it in. As easy as that, throw in a couple of pauses and hang on. If you're fishing shallower water, again, you can fish jet baits like sweeper, slider, especially if there's water where there's a lot of prey fish in it, like roach and perch, stuff like that. I prefer using like realistic patterns. For example, slider, you won't get much more realistic than that. Again, I've caught so many big fish fishing rainbow trout replicants. Size wise, 18 centimetre replicants, 16 centimetre sliders, that sort of thing. Big pike, although they will take big trout or big prey items, I prefer just giving them a mouthful. You'll catch pike of all different sizes. To be honest, I don't find that I catch any bigger pike using bigger lures. I certainly catch more pike using modest sized lures. And I've had big pike on small 4-inch lures. So I think the most important thing is to mix it up a bit, see what's working, and use what's working, basically. Enjoy it as much as you can and see what's happening. Next question is from Gary Graham. He asks, what is your favourite colour of replicant and what's your current PB on a replicant? I think it's no prizes for guessing what one it is. It's the 18cm rainbow trout, realistic rainbow trout. I've caught so many pike on that, so many 20-plussers. My current PB on that lure is £31. It was a cracking fish. On the day that I caught it, was a very cold easterly wind in November. I was wearing Polaroids, but the waves were that bad. I could only see about a foot under the water surface. The water was gin clear, but because of the waves, I couldn't see that far into the water. And I was anchored up in this bay, and it was quite a weedy bay, so I was fishing replicants quite fast. It was only 7.5 foot of water, so I was casting it, I was holding the rod tip up, trying not to let the replicant sink, quite fast right into the weed, and follow after follow of big pike, 25 plus every fish. The first fish I got was £26, after that I got another 20, 21 and a half or something, another 20. And I was just drifting out of the bay, and just as I got to the end of the bay, one cast, let it sink slightly because it was slightly deeper water there. Just bring it up, threw in a pause, bang, all the way in. Brilliant. It's moments like that you always remember. And that's my favourite part of replicant. I've catched so many fish on it. I don't know whether it's a confidence thing or not, but matching the hatch, as they say, with trout fishing. It's a rainbow trout replicant. The fish are used to eating rainbow trout. That's my go-to lure. First one I clip on in the box, and it's a banker for me. Next question is from Michael Smith. He asks, do you consider catching a big pike skill, or is it just down to plain old luck? I think you can be lucky a few times, but to continually catch big pike, I think there's a certain degree of skill involved, especially when there's other anglers fishing. A good angler will always wickle fish out, no matter what. Like I said earlier, when I answered one of the other guys' questions, when you're lure fishing as much as I am, you learn so much, and you learn how to put fish in the boat when times are hard. The thing is, when it comes to deadbaiting, there's not much skill in that. You throw a deadbait out in a spot, especially a spot where you know big pike come out of. A pike doesn't know whose deadbait's whose, or there's a huge degree of luck in that. But when it comes to lure fishing, certainly there's a great deal of skill involved. I know the same again, you can cast out a replicant, wind it back and catch a big pike. Happens all the time. But to consistently catch big pike, yeah, I do think there's a degree of skill involved. Next up is another question from Matt Wooldridge. He says, what makes you decide when to bait fish and when to fish lures? And also, do you think bigger baits result in bigger pike? I think the one thing that I always pick when a fish lures or baits is determined by water clarity. If the water's crystal clear, my confidence is sky high catching on lures. If it's murky, or it's got a brown tinge to it, or it's peaty, my confidence is low. I want the pike to be able to see my lures. So then that's when I decide to fish baits, especially the same with water temperature. Early in the season, I'm gung-ho with lures. But once it starts getting colder, the fish have had a good feed. They're not so inclined to chase lures. So they much prefer an easier meal like deads. That's when I fish it. That's when I feel confident. Like I said earlier, it's all about knowing what they want and when to do it, basically. Try and make the most of your situations. Next, what else did they say? Do you think bigger baits result in bigger pike? No. Most of the times I'm using five inch baits. Sort of like sardines, halfy blueies. Just a mouthful for a pike, just a snack. I think a lot of the time, especially when the water's cold, bigger baits take longer to digest. If it's a small meal, a pike can feed as and when it needs to. Especially the same goes with when you're hooking the fish. If you get a run on a 5-inch bait, both trebles are going to be in its mouth pretty much. If you're fishing an 8-inch mackerel, especially the way that your trebles are going to be spaced apart, it's going to be hard to get a hook hold. The last thing you want to do is leave a run saying that, trying to get the hooks in the mouth of a fish. It's not really a done thing. You want to strike early, make sure the hooks are in the mouth. So for me, that's it. 5-inch baits, easy peasy, job done. Next question is from Matthew Ferron. I hope I said that right. He says, I love fishing with a float, but does it work for pike? Yes. Yes, it does. I use a float all the time, whether it's a drifter float or a slider. That's what I'm using 90% of my float fishing, especially when I'm fishing from the boat. You can Google how to set up a float rig or go on YouTube. There's lots of videos out there on how to do it. Basically, I've cleaned all my rods the last couple of days. I've been that bored. I've dismantled everything, put new braid on all my lines, but I've not set them up yet. So this was one I did earlier. I cut a rig down. Basically, my main line's 65 pound braid. That's what I use for the majority of my pike fishing. I use a 10-foot rod, 6,000 size bait on a reel. Like I said, main line 65 pound. Put a stop knot on the line, which is out of fly backing. This determines what depth the float will fish at. Below the stop knot, I've got a small bead, which the float buffs up against. That stops against my stop knot. I'm using 35 gram inline slider float. That's what I use all the time. Nice, lightweight, easy float, very visible, very little resistance for the pike when it's taken. Below that is a 25 gram or 1 ounce in old money egg sinker, quick change weight, and that's tied directly to the swivel and quick link, which just makes taking your trace on and off a lot easier. The reason I use this, I've boat fished for pike for a long, long time. I've float fished for them. And this is the rig that over the years I've came to find is the best. It's quite a versatile rig. I can, for example, using these weights, even the rubber at the stop acts as a bit of a buff, but I can flip it around the other way. I can fix the lead to the swivel. I can increase the distance on my stop knot, fishing over depth. And I can pop a bait up. I use long 2-foot traces, so there's no chance of a bite off. And there's very little resistance in the rig itself. One thing I will say, when you're setting up a float, everything's determined by your stop knot. If you want to fish effectively, for example, if you're fishing 10-foot of water, you want that stop knot set at 11 and a half foot, 12 foot max. That way you're fishing 2 foot over bottom, your float's going to sit like that on the surface. When you get a take, it's going to cock up or it's going to go straight under. That's where you want to keep an eye on. if you're too much over depth, what's going to happen is the line is going to slide through the float all the way until it hits the bead, and then it'll go. You don't know how long that's been happening for. Especially when the water's cold, the pike can just sit, take your bait, swallow it. You've got a deep hooked fish. It's the last thing you want. You want to know straight away when you're getting a run. Wind in, hit that fish, make sure the hooks are in the corner of the mouth or easily accessed, that you can unhook them and not cause any harm to the fish. So that's it, that's my basic float rig, and that's what I use the majority of the time. Give it a go. Right, last question, and the winner that I've picked is Jamie Armstrong. Well done, mate. He asks, what got you into pike fishing? Do you still love it the same as you did? And if so, why? And also, when fishing lures, what depths do you tend to try first? Well, I'll start with what depths I finish for. I start with first. Especially when I'm fishing the water for the first time that I know nothing about, I'll always go around the edges. That's your main feature on any water, is around the edges. That's where most fish are going to be, with the exception of the really cold depths of winter, where most fish are likely to be in the deepest part of the water. But around the edges, that's your main feature. That's where fish are going to be. That's where most of your weed is, most of your features. That's where pike will be, basically. Second part of the question, what got you into pike fishing? I've pike fished, I'm 32 year old, I've pike fished since I was 14. I used to pick up Angler's Mail magazine, The Angler Times, see all these big pike, watch fishing channels on Discovery Shed, things like that, watch guys like Gord Burton, Des Taylor, and Mick Brown out catching all these big pike. And I thought, oh, I'd love to catch one of them. They were just mysterious and magical and big, crazy, angry looking fish. I always thought I could see myself catching one of them. That's what I wanted to do. A local water close to me where I grew up and sort of served my pike and apprenticeship one, if you like. I was a young guy, maybe about sort of 14, 15 year old. My mother used to take me up, drop me off, and I would fish all the time. All my childhood was spent on this water. I was fishing lures. I'd get waders every few months because I was getting holes in them. My mum was going crazy. That was my life. I used to get in amongst the reeds, casting lures, seeing these big pike follow me in, and I just knew that's what I wanted to do. I used to go fish the same water, catching trout. I used to win a lot of competitions, trout competitions. But I was fishing for pike and catch these big trout and win these competitions. The reason that you've won today is because I think that question that you said, do you still love it? Yes, I love it. I'll always love fishing. Fishing's in my blood. It's the last thing I think about, and it's the first thing I think about when I wake up. When I go to sleep, I'm dreaming about pike. I'm always trying to think about how I'm going to catch the next big pike, what I'm going to do different from everybody else, what's going to set me a steed from everybody else, and to continually catch big pike. And that love, that's what we all go for. That's something that drives us in our pike fishing. That's something that we can all relate to, especially during hard times like this, where I don't know when we're going to get next out fishing. So just that love that keeps us going, that love of fishing. So well done, mate. Good luck.